Hello, beautiful people. Welcome to the Azores, the pearl of the Atlantic. Let's go. Located in the middle of Atlantic Ocean, the Azores are often referred to as European Hawaii. The islands were first discovered in 15th century by Portuguese navigators. As a result, first settlers here were people from Portugal's mainland, along with small groups of Flemings that came here around 16th and 17th centuries. Because of its geographical location, at the time the Azores became the center of international trade between Europe, America, and India. Another benefit of its location is mild and very consistent temperature all year around. This results in lush vegetation and fertile soils. Because of its isolation from the entire world, the Azores almost serve as a natural laboratory for planet's flora, as you can find many endemic species here. Having remained relatively off the radars for many years, the islands are largely untouched, which prompted me to pack my bags and come here to see what this place is all about. With only 10% of the land used for commercial and residential purposes, there is lots of space for agriculture here. This fact makes cows' life here heaven on earth. The reason I'm mentioning them is because cows have become an essential part of the Azorean Islands. The region has been always recognized for its highest quality dairy products. They even have a so-called Happy Cows program here that allows them to roam freely all year around, which in turn adds more charm to the beautiful Azorean landscapes. The Azores is the most secluded archipelago in the Northern Hemisphere. Canada is located 2,500 kilometers to the west, and Portugal is located 1,500 kilometers to the east. Located in the middle of Atlantic Ocean, the Azores consist of 9 volcanic islands. I started my journey with the largest and most populated island of São Miguel. In the early 15th century, this was the second island discovered on the archipelago, and nowadays it is the most developed island in the Azores. My introduction to the largest island of São Miguel begins with its capital, a cosmopolitan town of Ponta Delgada. It offers the visitors a mix of contemporary life with historic flavor. Here you will find century-old buildings, monuments, and cobblestone streets, contrasting with modern marina, restaurants, and oceanfront cafes. By the way, speaking of cobblestone streets and just tiling in general, here they can be found everywhere. And I mean everywhere, on the sidewalks, on the roads, on the walls, and it looks like a true work of art. This adds to a very unique and authentic look of the town. Unless you want to dine at the fancy restaurants and mingle with tourists, there isn't much to do in Ponta Delgada. The true beauty of São Miguel is found outside its capital's walls. Speaking of tourism, the Azores is the first place ever to be recognized as the most sustainable tourist destination in the world. The Azorean government, alongside with local communities and the tourism industry partners, have all committed to preserve the culture, land, and the ecosystem. Over the past few decades, there were few ambitious projects put in place to attract more tourists. However, not all of them were successful. An example is the Grand Monte Palace Hotel. Built in the 1980s, the hotel was intended to be the ultimate luxury tourist spot in São Miguel. Yet, just after 18 years of operation, the owners declared bankruptcy and left the hotel to its elements. Nowadays, it is an abandoned building, and because of its emergency state, it's heavily guarded from unauthorized visitors. I was able to sneak in just to show you what it looks like from the inside, but let's keep it our little secret.
I can definitely see why the location was chosen for the hotel. It's amazing scenery here, and it's a shame that the hotel itself is in such a bad shape. However, I heard that a group of investors actually bought this hotel back, and they're supposed to fix it and make it operational within the next couple of years.
Speaking of the location, just check out the view that opens up from one of the rooms from this hotel. The views from Monte Palos Hotel led me to one of the most recognized landmarks of São Miguel Island, Sete Cidades Lake. The name of the lake, which by the way means seven cities, comes from a small village located at the base of the volcano. The village of Sete Cidades is a typical Azorean parish with a population of only 750 residents. But the main attraction here is the lake that sits right at the base of the volcano. It's about 4 kilometers long and 2 kilometers wide. What makes it a very popular attraction are the two lagoons, Lagoa Verde, which means green lake, and Lagoa Azul, which means blue lake. They are linked by a shallow channel, and the color differences are due to the light reflections from the lake. If you hike around here, I promise you, you will never forget these views. As I have mentioned before, a big part of islanders' life is agriculture. There are different types of farms spread out across the Azores, but some can only be found on São Miguel. One of them is pineapple plantation. Established at the beginning of 20th century by Dr. Augusto Arruda, this plantation is a set of rectangular greenhouses covered by hundreds of whitewashed glass windows. Pineapples here go through six different stages until they can be harvested.
Pineapples are a very important fruit for São Miguel Island. They were introduced by Portuguese navigators who brought it from Central and South America. And pineapples were considered as ornamental plant. Wealthier families like to keep it in their homes for decoration. Around 19th century, a big plague hit in Ireland, and production of oranges, which was the main crop at the time, had to stop. So islanders switched to pineapples that only take 2 years to fully grow. Since then, pineapple has become a very, very important plant for the island of São Miguel.
Delicious.
There was another unique place that's very specific to the island of São Miguel, and it had to do with agriculture as well. I really wanted to see it, and so I headed north towards a small parish of Porto Formoso. Here I found one of the Europe's only two tea plantations, Chá Porto Formoso. Everyone probably knows that history of tea goes back thousands and thousands of years, and most associated with Asia. But not everyone knows that there are two tea plantations in Europe located just a few kilometers apart, and they are here on the island of São Miguel. Tea is being farmed and processed here.
Starting a tea business was very risky. It requires a lot of capital investment. It requires a lot of time for harvesting and for basically maintaining the plantations, as well as it requires a lot of sophisticated tools to proceed with the production. So only a few families in the Azores decided to go ahead and start production of the tea. They brought the experts from Macau, China, to help them oversee the production and harvesting of the tea. As of right now, there are only two companies that are still left, and they both operate on this island of São Miguel. And from what I've been told, the Azorean tea is quite popular in the Western Europe. So I get here and I start walking around the plantation. The lady comes out, she gives me a private tour, puts the movie for me, like educational historical movie about the production of tea here. And then they give me a cup of tea, and then I ask them how much, and it's free here, so you can't go wrong. Definitely, if you have time, just stop by here for half an hour. Great experience.
Presence of 26 active volcanoes, 8 of which are located underwater, has always had its impact on the islands. São Miguel comprises of 6 volcanic zones. Over the years, the eruption of volcanoes shaped the island, as well as created small chunks of land in the ocean known to us as islets. Created through volcanic activity, these are usually uninhabited chunks of rocks in the sea. However, just south of São Miguel, and adjacent to a small town of Villa Franco do Campo, I found a very special islet. What sets this islet apart from the others is its perfectly round shape, with a diameter of 150 meters.
Up until 1980s, the islet of Vila de Franco was owned by a wealthy Portuguese family. But at some point, the Azorean government decided to buy back the property and turn it into a local and touristy spot. Right now, they have a bunch of excursions coming in there by boat. And during summer months, you can also use it as a beach vacationing for a daily trip.
It should not come as a surprise that living amongst volcanoes, locals learn how to take advantage of it. Because of volcanic activity, São Miguel is home to many mineral hot springs, which provide health benefits along with unmatched levels of relaxation. These are scattered across the island and serve as wellness spots. The variety is large, from natural pools heated by volcanic vent embedded straight into the Atlantic Ocean to steamy iron-rich pools located up in the mountains amid lush forests.
Just a quick tip, if you decide to go in one of those natural pools, make sure you wear black or old swimwear because there's a high concentration of iron in the water and it'll stain pretty much everything, especially jewelry like silver or whatnot.
Perhaps one of the most interesting places related to volcanoes is located around Furnas village. Besides beautiful views, Furnas offers a unique attraction called Cozido nas Caldeiras, or cooking in hot springs. Variety of local meats and vegetables is slow cooked in the pots dipped underground in the volcano heated steam halls. Around noon, staff takes these pots out of the ground and brings them to a local restaurant. I honestly, after watching all this, couldn't resist and had to try a small snack.
Wow. Eating the food that was cooked by Mother Earth. Mother Nature, thank you.
Okay, it sounds so good, but what about negatives, you'll ask me? Well, presence of volcanoes had its negative impact also, and it's evident by a coastline that is made solely of volcanic rock. If you're looking for a beach with white sand, you won't find it here. Also, you can't really swim here as the ocean gets really rough around afternoon and it becomes quite dangerous. Another negative thing, which is typical to a place located in the middle of the ocean, is unpredictable weather. Here's me stopping for a coffee with no indication of a storm whatsoever. And next thing you know, 2 minutes later, this happens. Driving across the island of São Miguel, I passed through many towns. The one that I really liked was a small town called Ribeira Grande. About 18 kilometers northeast of Ponta Delgada, Ribeira Grande was one of the first settlements on São Miguel Island, and it is evident from the urban architecture dating as far as 17th century. The 8 Arcs Bridge and an old amphitheater located beside the water channel add charm to the landscape of this beautiful town. I've really enjoyed walking around town's historic center with its narrow streets and colorful buildings. Perhaps the most notable building is the small parish church of Espirito Santo. Its Baroque-influenced architecture makes it one of the most attractive on the island. By the way, speaking of churches, because the Azores is part of Portugal with over 80% of population being Christian, it comes as no surprise that the islands are home to many beautiful churches. For me personally, one of them stood out. Built in the 18th century and located on a hill overlooking the ocean, a chapel of Nossa Senhora da Paz is a must-see. São Miguel's unofficial name is a green island. It is surrounded by the magical forest that kept seducing me every time I passed by. I really wanted to go in and experience it myself. So I heard about this hidden gem of a lake located at the base of caldera surrounded by a lush forest. So I decided to drop my car and, regardless of the weather, to go in and find it.
Honestly, I feel like I'm in Amazon forest, just walking through the jungle. Especially on a rainy day, it gives that feel of a rainforest. Very rewarding hike.
After about 30 minutes, somewhat challenging hike in rain and mud, I finally reached my destination. The beautiful Lagoa Congro opened up in front of my eyes. And the best thing, there was absolutely no one around it.
I knew something beautiful was waiting for me at the end of this hike, but this is something incredible. The color of this water is as green as my eyes or this jacket. And the trip itself, the hike itself, that took about 25 to 30 minutes, coming down this last greenery, incredible jungle-like forest, is absolutely incredible.
If you're not a fan of extreme hikes and still want to experience the lush vegetation of São Miguel Island, don't worry, I found a place just for you. Ladies and gentlemen, please meet Terra Nostra Park, probably one of the most fascinating places on São Miguel Island, featuring more than 2,000 different trees from all over the world.
I honestly feel like I opened some encyclopedia and just teleported there. And I'm going from page to page. So many different types of vegetation, trees, flowers. Absolutely incredible experience.
The history of Terra Nostra Park is deeply connected with development of nearby village of Furnas. It dates back to 18th century when an American merchant purchased a lot of land to build a summer house here.
Terra Nostra Park back in the day used to be a private estate, and the guy who owned it, he decided to bring different types of vegetation from different parts of the world and just grow it on the property, just so it can be preserved
here on the island of Azores, since the climate is very, very favorable for different types of vegetation.
In the mid-19th century, the property was rebought and the owner decided to mimic English gardens here. Finally, in 1930s, the first summer resort was built here, which became a popular site among locals and foreign visitors, who could not resist visiting Terra Nostra to bathe in geothermal swimming pool and marvel at magnificent views admiring exotic vegetation. Finally, I've reached the eastmost point of São Miguel Island, a beautiful village of Nordeste. The red roofs of the houses among green fields and high cliffs here reminded me of Irish countryside with a tropical kick to it. Nordeste itself is a quiet coastal town, and perhaps the most notable attraction here is the lighthouse indicating the end of São Miguel Island. The views here are top-notch. São Miguel had many beautiful attractions, and it is extremely hard to pick my favorite. Though, if I had to do it, I'd probably pick the viewpoints that are scattered across the island. You see, because São Miguel is an island surrounded by cliffs, if you drive along the coastline, no matter where you stop, you will be treated with incredible views. Some of these viewpoints are converted into small parks, which makes the whole experience so much more enjoyable. I honestly love just taking a break from driving, randomly stopping and admiring the beauty of this place. São Miguel, you were great. Muito obrigado.